Dan. It's great to have you along here with us. Well, I'm just thinking over the weekend, why is it that everybody in Australia chooses to go shopping on Saturday morning, huh? Like, it's this herd mentality. We think in Australia we're much better than the hunters and gatherers of many years ago, but, you know, they managed to incorporate shopping into their day jobs. 200 years ago, you didn't see the Aborigines lining up with kangaroos and emu eggs at the 8 items or less checkout for hours on end on a Saturday morning. You know why? Because they knew that Saturday morning was a very good time to sleep in. And you know why Saturday morning is a good time to sleep in? Because Friday is drinking night. I woke up this Saturday morning with a big Force 10 hangover, right? Go to the fridge, nothing in the fridge. Think, right, I have to go to the supermarket and battle all those marauding women with shopping trolleys and snivelling kids saying, we want Cocoa Pops, we want Cocoa Pops. And the last thing you need to do is to make a decision when you've got a bad hangover. Like, I nearly got a cerebral hemorrhage trying to decide between Coles New World and Safeway. But these days you go to a supermarket and it's like a final year ecology and ideology exam, isn't it? Remember when the only thing you had to know about shampoo when it was for normal, dry or oily hair? Remember that? Now you have to know, where was the shampoo made? If I buy it, will it adversely affect the balance of payments for the September quarter? If it wasn't made in Australia, which third world country was devastated by a petrochemical spill at the point of manufacture? What are the recycling opportunities for my plastic bottle? Will this product go down the sewers and kill schooling fish at the ocean outfall? And finally, do I want to really put hydrobenzodimoxychlorine on my head? You try to buy milk. Do you want to pasteurise, homogenise, fat-reduced, protein-enriched, extra-dollop, ultra-filtered, strawberry, chocolate, caramel or soy milk? Whatever happened to milk? And you can't buy eggs without thinking about the emotional welfare of the chickens. You can't buy beef without wondering whether the cloven-hooved animals are destroying the nation's delicate topsoil. And you can't buy tuna without giving tacit support to a race of dolphin killers, right? So your protein options are running pretty damn low. You think, aha, fruit and vegetables. And you go to the fruit and vegetable department, right, because it's cholesterol and fat-free. But unfortunately, these days, it's also taste-free. You can't buy the broccoli without running a Geiger counter over it. I mean, you don't think it grows that green by itself, do you? And the apples taste like they're sprayed with Scotch Guard, because they are. So you see, you can't buy tin food because it's not fresh, and you can't buy fresh food because it's full of preservatives. Actually, this is something. Did you know that the human corpse used to take only 3 days to decompose? These days it's got so many preservatives in it, it can take up to a week. And you can get that up to 2 weeks with regular exercise. So there I am. I'm walking out of the supermarket. What have I got? I've got half a kilo of organically grown mouldy tomatoes. I've got a bottle of biodynamic pear juice. I've got some loose lentils and some unbleached toilet paper. This way, if you're going to eat the lentils, you're going to need the toilet paper. All in my string bag, which has been made by Nicaraguan peasants and smuggled out by sympathetic nuns, and I head for the car park. I get to where I think my car is, but I remember, I've been too guilty to bring my car because it pumps carbon monoxide into the atmosphere and it burns up non-renewable fossil fuels. By this time, the lentils have fallen through the holes in the string bag and the tomatoes are turned into chutney. All right, I'll go to where I park my bike, except my bike isn't there, is it? Because it's been stolen along with the no standing sign I chained it to. And I can't go and report it to the police because I, as a member of the oppressing race, colour and socio-economic strata, do not want to in any way contribute to the dreary life of some poor youth who's been forced into stealing by the degradation of the capitalist system. Besides, who wants to ring the pigs when you got $500 of unpaid parking fines?
I'm finished.
walking home in my ideologically sound non-leather shoes, i.e. my thongs. And I suddenly think, hang on a minute. How long does it take a thong to decompose? I better take these off and dispose of them thoughtfully. No, and then I thought, no, I'll put them back on, because the only way a thong can disintegrate is while you're wearing them, okay? So I'm walking along, walking home, thinking, it's really, really hot. And I start thinking, hot, heat, sunshine, hole in ozone layer, skin cancer. Better duck into the pub and have a drink, yes. What'll it be in the pub? Okay, will I have a beer made by a Chilean sympathiser? Or will I have a champagne made by a French nuclear tester? Okay, I'll go for the vodka. It's Polish, support solidarity, right? And I don't know how many of you have ever tried to drink a shitload of vodka before midday on a Saturday, but the rest of the afternoon was a complete horrible blur. I woke up 5 hours later, face down the pile of polystyrene and waste paper, and realised I'd eaten 4 Big Macs, drunk 2 litres of Coke, and bought 6 Ronald McDonald and Hamburglar plastic cups. And you know what? I felt human again. You know what I'm going to do next weekend? I'm going to go roo shooting in the national park. That's why I'm going to spend my weekend. I think ideologically sound is really hell. I tell you what, ladies and gentlemen, the exodus from the Eastern Bloc continues, does it not? And here we've got a group of guys who are just fresh from over the wire. I know you're going to love them. We do here. The Bachelors from Prague.
What? The obvious.
Don't they know that things come naturally?
Is it that the greenbacks,
the only real God?
The passports to a happier life.
Brrr, yeah.
Guess what? Look sharp. Wise up. Wow. Don't accept things on face value. Guess what? Look sharp. Wise up, brrr. Don't accept things on face value.
Come on, tell me about it, Jeffrey, come on. Why does everybody look
the same? Is it Mother Nature playing a game? Woody jumpers, but they're the ones who are getting sleeks. Brrr, yeah.
Guess what? Look sharp. Wise up. Well, don't accept things on face value. Guess what? Look sharp. Wise up. Meow. Don't accept things on face value.
A saxophone, saxophone, saxophone.
Turn our stereotypes into individuals.
We must cultivate the cult of personality.
We gotta remodel our role models
and swap nationalism for worldism.
It's wrong. Look sharp. Why
accept things at face value.
News update. The mining industry intends to follow up the bulldozing of Kakadu National Park with an exciting plan to strip mine Ayers Rock for food additives. Taste tests revealed that Uluru is 90% MSG, said a greedy fat spokesman in a yellow hard hat. We can put a taste of Australia into everything from prawn balls to hung low duck. Tourism would not be affected, added the press release, since miners would refill the sacred site with toxic waste and take away food containers, level it off with spack filler, and paint it brown. Oh dear. Whatever happened to the good old days when the sheep was king and we all got rich filling the world with fluffy cardigans? Memo to all staff. On-air fraternization. Save that sort of thing for the back of the panel van. Instant dismissal. Go away. Opera. Following a 6-bar win in the mostly Mozart grudge match against the Joan Sutherland All-Stars in Helsinki, Australia's trust-busting baritone Enzo Rubberlips Spinetti is now ready to hunker down for the Così Fan Tutti tag event against Pavarotti in Pisa. Enzo's going to cream the Pav, boasted trainer Convio. His top D flat could stop an elephant, and in Helsinki he pulled off one of the longest cadenzas in living memory. Go for it, Enzo. Back to the barricades.
Hey! There you go! Two weeks ago, I bought this little puppy dog. Aww. His name's Dylan. He's gorgeous. He's terrific. He's great. He's a blue heeler, border collie, kelpie, Doberman cross with a bit of Chihuahua. He's got a patch on one eye and a lousy depth of field, and he's as cute as a button. Except he's more expensive to maintain. He does more poos than a button. Anyway, I'm training him at the moment, this little lovely little dog, and I believe in the firm hand approach with a puppy. So I say, no, Dylan, no, no, you cannot, no, don't bite my slippers. You can wear them, but you cannot bite them. No good licking me. No, sit. Don't you walk away from me when I'm talking to you. Right, you're in big trouble now, puppy. Right, you've got those slippers for 5 more minutes and I want them back. One word from me, he does exactly as he wants. So I thought I'd take him to the zoo last week, you know, show him where he fitted into the animal kingdom. Because he has no bloody idea. And you know you're not allowed to take pets to the zoo, so I thought I'd disguise him as a baby in a pram. A baby in a pram that barks. A baby in a pram with a hairy face that barks with a sharp little teeth. So I took the pram up to the zoo, and the guy at the zoo said, oh, that's not a baby. I said, you've hurt his feelings now. She's all, sorry, in you go. Make sure you keep your baby on a leash. So I did, right? And we're walking down, you know, walking down. And I took him up to the tiger's cage. And there was this great big tiger there, and he was staring me right in the eyes, and I was staring at him in mutual admiration. And they're amazing. Shut up. They're amazing animals, aren't they? I mean, they're sleek, they're so graceful, and they're very strong. They have amazing eyes, and I have absolutely no idea of what he thought about me, but he did go like this. I said, let's get out of here, Dylan. And then we went to the giraffe cage, and we saw this giraffe there, and he was trying to eat this leaf at the very, very top of the tree, and he was reaching out with his tongue out, going... It couldn't quite reach. He was really trying hard, and I felt sorry for him. He just went, So I shouted out, I said, stand on your toes, dickhead. And he went, oh, yeah. a lot, and it changed his life completely. Then we went to see the tortoises. I don't know what it is, but whenever I see a tortoise, why does it always remind me of someone who works in the post office? Now, I went into the post office last week. I took in a parcel. I had to go to Germany, and, you know, I had to go over there for Christmas, and I took it and I said, I'd like this parcel to go to Germany, please. The guy said, how's it going? And I said, pretty good, thanks. Now, would you send this to Germany? Back to the zoo. We're at the tortoise cage, right? And I saw this male tortoise, very short-sighted male tortoise. He was chatting up this motorcycle helmet for 3 hours. And, then he mounted it. And he said to the motorcycle helmet, did you come yet? And the female tortoise says, no, I'm over here. And the male tortoise turned around and said, damn, I wish I was a rabbit. I get through 6 helmets in an hour. So I took my little puppy home, and I took him home, and I said, well, Dylan, did you have a good time at the zoo? And he looked up at me and went, which is doggy for yes. And he found out where he fitted into the animal kingdom. The next day, he ran away. And I haven't seen him. And I miss him. No, I can't eat because he's taken the can opener. So please keep your eye out for a little puppy. He's got a little red bonnet, a nice little matinee jacket, and a lovely pair of slippers. Thank you very much.
Rachel Virgo, fantastic stand-up comedian who's a very close personal friend of mine. In fact, she only just lives right round the corner from my house. She's been away for a couple of months. She's been over at the Edinburgh Festival where she kicked ass. She did very well. And she worked around the clubs in London, and we're very pleased to have her back, and we're very proud of her. And I hope you make her very welcome, Miss Rachel Virgo.
You travel over to the other side of the world and you find out that people are into the same ridiculous things as they are at home, like Garfield dolls. I mean, they're so stupid, you know. I mean, the whole idea of adults into soft toys is really sick. Unless it's at the end of the bed with a zipper in the middle, otherwise known as the boyfriend. I mean, these angst little dolls, you know, imagine you go out one night, you get really, really drunk. You wake up in the morning, you don't know which half of your body to put on the toilet first. You know that feeling? I thought you could relate. And you get into the car, and there in the back window of the car in front of you is a doll that looks exactly how you feel. In fact, I have this theory, actually, that a premenstrual woman maybe invented the Garfield doll. Because that's what it's like, girls, isn't it? I mean, really, you go to bed one night, you're normal, you're human. You wake up the next morning, it's like... Aah! The boyfriend says, it's okay, I'll get breakfast in town. What about the other sign that you see on cars? It's a yellow diamond-shaped one that says, baby on board. Who gives a shit? I see one of those signs, I just want to drive right into the back of the car. What are you supposed to do, drive by slowly? Sing a lullaby? I saw one car that had a sign on it said, nobody on board. Volvo. Oh, we do love Volvo drivers. Our whole life is actually dominated by these signs. When you go into the bank these days, there's a sign on the bank door, and it's a bike helmet with a great big red slash through it. And what it means is that you can't go into the bank with a bike helmet on. You can go in with a stocking over your head. But not with a bike helmet. In fact, I think that we should have some sort of head protection when we go into a bank, because bank tellers are very weird people. I mean, really, I have never seen more people with addictions to Clearasil in my entire life. The reason, it's true, the reason there's a piece of glass between you and the teller is, God forbid, the teller should go... Tellers would actually actually speak to you. You know, they'd say, hi, Rach, how are you? Did you have a good day? You know, now they don't. The only thing they say to you is, how would you like that? And I always feel like saying, up your ass, sweetheart. Because you spent 50 minutes of a sort of 60-minute lunch hour waiting, you know, standing there in the queue, holding onto the little rope, you know, like on the Love Boat. Surrounded by posters telling you about early retirement schemes, and you realise that's how long you're going to be waiting for. But the best place to actually see this kind of new techno speak is when you go on an aircraft, as I have just done. Because they have little signs like telling you about the safety belts and to, you know, take a cigarette, don't go back to your seat, do all that kind of stuff. And I think they should have one for airline stewardesses. And I think it should be a skull and a crossbone. Because I have decided that airline stewardesses actually don't like women. Haven't you ever noticed how bitchy they are to women? They learn that at Smile Academy. I get on the aircraft and I've got my boarding pass. And there's Stewie. And Stewie says, good morning, madam. Which translated means, keep moving cellulite thighs. The guy behind me gets on and she's like, welcome aboard, sir. Which translated means, I can make you real hard. It's true. And they're really prissy. I go on a flight 5, 6, 7, 8 hours. I look, feel and smell like I've been dead for 3 years, right? Not Stewie. Stewie comes down the aisle like this. Regulation nape of the neck ponytail. Not one blackhead worth squeezing. Looking like she just stepped out of a panty liner commercial. Would you like a magazine? Rack off. And they're so condescending. Have you ever noticed those sort of the safety instructions they give you? They say things to you like, in case of an emergency, an oxygen mask will fall from the unit above your head. Just place this over your nose and mouth. Where else am I going to put it? It's inflatable and you put it on and when you land in the sea this tiny little whistle appears on the side of it. Who the hell is going to hear you in the middle of the ocean with that little whistle? They should give you a fun whistle with a feather on the end so you can have a really good time while you're dying. Now they even have a more modern device. It's inflatable. You put it on and when you land in the sea all these green iridescent strips appear so that you can watch all your friends drowning around you. Modern science, the absolute one I loathe the most is when you get to a pedestrian crossing, right, and you stand there and you press the button and ahead of you appears a little green man, never a little green woman. And the sort of sound that you hear immediately afterwards is dick, 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 dick. Be reminded at every street corner. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Good evening. Here's a further news update. The mining industry has followed up its visionary project to strip mine Ayers Rock with a scheme to dynamite the Great Barrier Reef for very small pieces of coral. Australia's on another winner, exclaimed a money-hungry vandal in a blue hard hat. People like me with Mercedes and BMWs like to cruise up long white driveways covered in fine, crunchy stuff. Now we know where to get it. Tourism would not be affected, he added, since the old-fashioned reef would be replaced with a postmodern concrete replica that lit up in the dark and took all major credit cards. Remember when we used to balance the books with golden sheaves of wheat? We used to wave to the freighters full of lamingtons and scones as they set sail for India and wish them well. Of course, I was very young.
Drop it.
Chamber music. It's been a day of triumph for the Australian middleweight string quartet which thrashed the pants off the USSR's volatile quartet Chernobyl during the mixed doubles Best of Brahms sonata in Bogota overnight. The pristine machine, captained by violin virtuoso Harpo G-String Spinetti, was commended for its thrusting appassionata in the passage where it really mattered. And Spinetti's tight leadership in the slippery first half. Harpo's a maniac, enthused coach Hal Legro. He can make a violin shout. Look out, world. Back to the bravado.
The Doug Anthony All-Stars. Oh, yes. The Doug Anthony All-Stars were in Sydney over the weekend on a book signing expedition. They managed to sign hundreds and hundreds of books till someone caught them and threw them out of the library. Stupid. Come on, let's hear it, gang. The Doug Anthony All-Stars.
This week, yes, we'd like to admit that we three boys believe in fairies. It's true, but the sad thing is the fairies have all been kidnapped by the Elven Queen. So if you want to save the fairies, everybody say, I believe in fairies.
I believe in fairies.
If you want to save the fairies and you love fairies, then give yourself a pixie clap. Give yourself a fairy clap. Ooh. Give yourself a zen clap.
Ooh. I can hear a tree falling.
Ah. Give yourself a Premier of Queensland, Russell Cooper clap.
I get the left or the right.
Ah, come on, you people, you silly old buggers. You're all silly old buggers for doing that. You know, I was thinking the other day, you do wait, don't you? You wait 3 years for the Prime Minister of this country to say something honest and truthful. And when he does, he apologises for it.
I think Bob Hawke's seriously out of touch with the silly old buggers of this country.
Yep. Why did he use the term silly old bugger when loudmouth, opinionated right-wing prick would have done? Or even, you dirty... ...from Queensland.
Now that's tough.
No, sorry, we retract everything he said, Ben. We retract all of that.
Yeah, we not only believe in fairies, we also believe in the Pilots Federation. If you think about it, they're both off with the pixies. But we're the only people who really believe in what the pilots are doing. I mean, some of those pilots only earn, what, 100 grand a year? That's not enough to keep their kids in crack for a week. And apparently the tourist industry is really reeling under this strike. And if the strike goes on for another 2 months, then apparently there will be virtually no American tourists coming to Australia at all.
Yeah, that's what we thought.
You're all picking on them just because they're Americans. It's not their fault. Leave them alone.
They can't help it. We'd like to do now a poem the fairies taught us for a happy Philippines. Thank you.
Oh, great.
Little Jack Horner sat in the corner eating his pudding and pie, stuck in his thumb, pulled out Ferdinand Marcos and said, I'm glad you're dead, you despot!
So, all the fairies have been kidnapped by the
Elven Queen!
And there's only one way to keep the fairies alive, and that's to keep the music alive. And there's only one band who can get the music alive, and they are the fantastic Spasmodic Bachelors from Prague!
Thanks, guys. I always said that youth was wasted on the young.
The chair is not a chair, but there's no one sitting there. And a house is not a home. If the renovator isn't there.
Shake your toes. Apparatus. Of course, is optional. This time round, one would prefer an IQ slightly larger than a boot size. And an ability to get on with one's in-laws would be an advantage. Now, sort off.
G'day! Would you like a painkiller that isn't too heavy and doesn't leave you with a splitting headache? Would you like a painkiller that doesn't leave you feeling... Would you like a painkiller with a bit of zip? Would I? Paradox! For when pain goes against the grain.
Whose grain?
My grain!
Okay then. Paradox knocks out toothache. Paradox rips into earache. And Paradox lays into backache. What about period pains? I had a sore arm in the 19th century, but Paradox cured my muscular ailment.
It could be a chest cold.
Could be hay fever. Paradox even beats phantom pain.
Hey, Mr. Walker. I use it too. Paradox also contains thiamine, niacin, iron, riboflavin, codeine, visine, strychnine, mung beans, protein, and Vaseline.
So it's guaranteed to get you off every time.
Case dismissed. Paradox comes in lots of different flavours.
And it's non-habit forming.
Suckling children. Not with Paradox childproof seal.
So if you're into pain, take five.
Take a whole packet.
Take Paradox.
And if pain persists, please.
Don't come whinging to us.
Watching the money or the gun on Saturday night. That's Andrew Denton's program here on the ABC. You should get on it. That's a fantastic program. If you were watching the money or the gun, you would have seen our next guest, Mr. Pepe. He was terrific. We liked him so much, we invited him to be on our show too. Here he is making welcome, Mr. Pepe.
Thank you very much, Andy. Absolutely charmed. Evening, everybody. Could you just imagine just for a little while that you're in the Caribbean? Thank you very much.
By the waters of the Caribbean lived the loveliest of Latin queens. In her bathing suit she can be seen strolling down beside the sea. But her bathing suit never got wet. Though she was an admiral's daughter and always so close to the water, but her bathing suit never got wet. Then one day, imagine to her surprise, clouds began to gather in the skies. There she stood just like a frightened pup as the heavens opened up. But her bathing suit never got wet, 'cause down by the beach was a fella. Now he had the cutest umbrella, so her bathing suit never got wet. Then one day she broke the golden rule, climbed the ladder of the swimming pool. There she stood, and as the people roared, she dived off that diving board. her bathing suit never got wet. But oh, what a lesson it taught her. What good's a pool without? So her bathing suit never got wet. So her bathing suit never got wet.
Thank you very much.
Cross Jane Fonda with Tinkerbell. Hmm? Give up? Candida, totally gorgeous. Hi! Oh, there you are. Guess what? I had this most unreal weekend. Yeah. Guess what happened? No, you couldn't. I saw my mum and dad. Yeah. And it's the first time I've seen them in 10 years and I saw them on the television. Yeah. I did, because you know how, like, doesn't matter how much time passes or, you know, what happens, like, your parents will always be your mother and father. It's true. It's because it's like in your jeans, yeah, like your legs, yeah. Yeah. Anyway, my parents, right, my parents are really entirely special because, like, they're sensitive and caring and loving and generous and they're totally spiritual and they left home in the late 70s, yeah, because they thought they were losing themselves as individuals because by being parents, yeah, and also, apart from that, they felt like they were really disappointed. Because you know how parents can often be disappointed, especially when they've got children. Well, what happened was, firstly what happened was, like, my sister, Ring of Bright Water, yeah, she changed her name to Glenda, yeah, and she married a butcher, yeah, and they opened a chain of speciality sausage shops. Yeah, I said that's easy for you to say. and that really upset my parents because, like, they brought us up to be vegetarians. They couldn't understand it. And then what happened was my brother, Frodo, he moved to the city and did a computer course and became a really successful stockbroker. Yeah, well, it broke their hearts. Yeah, because they always wanted him to be a spiritual leader. Yeah, that's why they devoted so much time and energy into not giving him an education. Yeah. But the final straw, right, that broke the camel's water, yeah, was me. Because I got full membership to the local gym. Yeah, and they had always wanted me to run away and live overseas. Yeah, anyway, they really sort of really totally lost it. Like, they freaked right out. They completely lost their will to finish building the mud brick house they've been working on since 1962. Yeah, one more wall and they would have had a room. Yeah. Anyway, so what happened, Dad freaked out. Oh, excuse me. Dad freaked out and he said he's just going to give everything up, like he was going to get a haircut, get a job, and Mum was going to let a pierced nose grow over and take up tennis. And then, excuse me, I'm going to get this. Then anyway, what happened then was instead, what they did was some toxin acid through the I Ching, and then they put Muhammad, the budgie, into the combi, and they went off to be free spirits. I really miss that budgie. Yeah, he taught me how to hang upside down, because that's all he did, I don't know why. Anyway, then I think the last I heard, right, was that they, I've got it. That's right. And the last I heard was got it. No, that's better. Thanks. Thank you. Right. The last. Oh. The last I heard, they'd moved up north to start a commune. You know, only nobody came. But you know, that's a lesson for them. Anyway, then what happened was on Friday night, right? I was watching TV. I was watching a video. Jane Fonda's low impact aerobics, right? Oh, that's it. Soft pelvic bounces. when all of a sudden, that's right. Okay. When all of a sudden the tape stopped and I accidentally started watching the news. Yeah, bummer. It was totally negative. But guess what? I saw Mum and Dad. They're at Narunga and they've just been arrested. Yeah. Totally fantastic. So I ran out to Narunga and I said, could I speak to a couple of the protesters? And they said, no, it was impossible. And I said, ha, you call yourself a communications base. And
them down to where they were staying in jail. And I'm all right, I'm all right. And anyway, so I sent them a lettergram. I said, "Dear Mum and Dad, hi, great to see you on TV, you're really funny. And I'm sending lots of good vibes, love Candida." And guess what? They sent me a telegram back, a lettergram back. They said, "Dear Candida, would prefer 15 Buddha sticks and $3,000. Yeah, love Snowdrop and Golden Shower. Yeah. I was totally blown out, you know? Like, they are so religious. Fancy thinking of Buddha at a time like that. Totally spiritual. Yeah. See ya.
I'm Troy, and I'm a professional ex-boyfriend, and I'd like to meet someone special, like you. Long after we break up, I'd still like to send you long-stemmed red roses on the anniversary of our first meeting, and still be invited to family gatherings by your mother. I enjoy holding a PhD in English literature, being able to rebuild Chevy engines, renovate houses, and generally just being there when you need someone and your boyfriend's interstate. I also enjoy wearing incredibly tight jeans to parties, bumping into your boyfriend, proving that I have a much bigger 11th finger than he does. Most of all, I just enjoy being an incredibly nice guy.
Good evening. Here's a final news update. The mining industry was thwarted today in its plans to demolish the members' bar of Parliament House in the search for any loose change that may have fallen down between the cracks in the parquet flooring. The politicians reckon that the Golden Trough Bistro is a sacred site, wept a vast executive covered in cigar ash and a green hard hat, where the mythical subsidised rainbow trout with chips and salad appeared every lunchtime for $3.95. A defiant Prime Minister defended the decision in the interest of tourism because a members' bar at Parliament House is the only wildlife park where Australians can come to see where all the money went. Once we didn't need tourism, we exported mulgwood ashtrays. Now we've killed them all off. There used to be flocks of mulga all over the sugar fields. Oh, my. Ow! Marathon walking. The Cindy Lauper of Australian marathon walking, Aldo Rubberhip Spinetti, will devote his latest comeback to walking backwards to Christmas across the Tasman Sea in support of the Melbourne's bid for the Olympic Games. "I know what I'm doing," announced the heavily greased Spinetti as he strapped on his inflatable Reeboks. Some people claim that holding the Olympics in Melbourne would be like making love in a bath full of pig's offal while wearing a sandpaper jockstrap. In there and it isn't. So I'm walking to Dunedin to show the world that it could be worse. Spinetti was last seen off the coast of New Zealand with a number of hostile canoes closing in. Oh dear. Oh well. Back to the boondocks.
That's almost it from us, except there's a lot more to go. I want to show you yes, I'm doing that. I'm holding it right. The Bachelors from Prague. Their new album is out, and it's called Birth of the Fool. Available at all good record shops everywhere. And for those folk who live in Melbourne, you can see them at ID's on Sunday night. So get down there and do yourself a favour, as they say. Here to take us out are the Bachelors from Prague.
He preaches if he means business. The guy in the three-piece suit, acting like he owns the place, looking for forbidden fruit. Take that mark and I'll do
certainly have strange tastes. This overconfident Don Juan in denim. He sees a picture of Julie Andrews and thinks it's John Lennon. Yeah. Take that mask. You're not fooling anybody with that bowling. You see, who's called for
Andrew Denton is recording a new series of Money or the Gun. If you'd like to be in the audience, then call the ABC tomorrow morning after 10 on 950-3465. That's 950-3465 after 10 a.m. tomorrow.
He certainly got lots of front. He's voguing it hoochie pull over. If he span him round and looked, at the back he'd be a push. Oh yeah. Take that mark. You're not fooling anybody with that moaning. You sheep. Who's golden? Ow. Sheep. 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 Ow.
Say goodbye. These are my friends. This is Melissa and this is Matthew, and they're all the way from Vinifera up in the Mallee. Come down to the Big Smoke. Say goodnight, guys. Goodnight. Bye.